Seguimos en Panorama con nosotros, Joseph Satar, fundador y dueño del Middle East, legendario lugar en Cambridge. El que no lo conozca, pues le sale regaño, porque tiene que venir a conocer uno de los lugares más legendarios en el estado de Massachusetts y en Boston. Y vamos a empezar con esa parte de la historia. Let's talk about what has happened in this place that has marked so many lives of celebrities, entertainers, entrepreneurs. Let's talk about some anecdotes. No, I don't want to focus on celebrities and musicians, because here many things has happened. Governors, politicians, entrepreneurs. So how can we summarize some stories of what Middle East means for the history of this city?
It's hard to answer that question out flat. It's all perspective how people think of the Middle East. But I'm so lucky. I'm in the middle of I get adopted by my community.
They think the world of me. Tengo mucha suerte de ser adoptado por la comunidad, y es difícil de resumir todos los éxitos de este lugar en una respuesta. So I'm going to help you. Let's go by sector and let's end with the music. Let's politicians. What can you say about former governors that has been here?
They've all been here. They've been here for their fundraising, they've been here for dining, they've been here for their campaign, they've been here sober, they've been a little out of line, but
todos
never
got out
of line.
Todos los gobernadores han estado acá para sus campañas políticas, para reuniones, han estado sobrios, han estado en otro tipo de situaciones. Which one would you remember the most?
I'm not going to mention name, but it's just proud to see, you know, my customer turn out to be college president, or be a congressman, or a senator, or even president. So Cambridge, we're very rich when it comes to that. You know, have two good colleges, you know, it's attract
global leaders too.
Exactly. So you have to be graduated from one of those schools if you want to be president of any country or any politician.
But can you remember like one table that you see, oh, look at all these people that are sitting over there?
The Kennedy is one of it. I mean, the Tip O'Neill, another one, you know, and so people used to come and dine in here regularly.
So muchísima gente del poder mundial, global, local y ciudad se ha sentado aquí en este lugar del Middle East. Realmente la historia que narra este que se respira en este sitio hace que el lugar permanezca, porque significa mucho para la ciudad y para el estado y para el mundo, porque recuerden que Cambridge es un corazón académico mundial. No hay, creo que uno de cada cinco líderes mundiales ha pasado de alguna manera por Boston y por Cambridge, o en alguna de sus escuelas, o en algún tipo de reunión. Y siempre el Middle East es algo que significa muchísimo para el tema del poder. So we go from power to music, which is one at the heart of Middle East at night, right?
It's exactly, and this is, I think, luck more than anything when it comes to the stage and music. And maybe that's why the politicians end up in here, you know, so they can't escape it. The neighbors want the Middle East, the non-profit want the Middle East.
So la música significa mucho para este negocio, y quizás ha sido el imán de tantas personalidades que han visitado este lugar. Musicians and your connection with the music world of Boston.
Exactly. The connection is, we started with small stages. So the small stage we start, we produce band nobody knows, and all of a sudden they become big, and they become ambassador for the Middle East out there on stages globally. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden all the big names want to come and play in here.
So many people.
It's so many people. It's not fair to, you know, name right. It, but just so.
So muchísimos músicos que quisieran llegar a las grandes lugares han pasado por el Middle East. Muchísimos de diferentes estilos de música, desde música internacional, música country, música rock, música ska, música punk. Todos han pasado por el Middle East. No?
I'll give you an example to make it easier for you. If you take Tony Bennett, for example.
Tony Bennett.
His son used to manage Red Hot Chili Peppers.
El hijo de Tony Bennett era el manager de Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Exactly. He used to go to BU. So his father was so impressed with him, said, if you'll manage me, you know, I'll go back to music. So the first show for Tony Bennett, come back, it was the Middle East upstairs, black tuxedo free show.
Managed by his son.
Managed by his son.
Miren esta historia que interesante. El hijo de Tony Bennett, estudiante de BU, manager de Red Hot Chili Peppers en aquella época, impresionó tanto a su papá que su papá le dijo, si tú me eres mi manager, yo regreso a la música. Y el primer concierto del regreso de Tony Bennett a la música fue aquí en el Middle East. What year are we talking about? Maybe
I have no idea. Early,
late 80s.
Exactly.
Sí, como en los últimos de los 80. Ahora, the music industry, it has changed dramatically. The venues industry has changed dramatically. I think you are one of the few independent venues left in town. It's like there's only one radio station independent left in town, the River,
exactly.
Right? There is one TV station independent, WCA, local community, which our show airs here in Boston. And there is, I think, House of Blues just started a few years ago, big corporation. Live Nation have bought out, I thought they were going to buy you out. Live Nation, have Live Nation
tried to? I mean, a lot of people want to buy me out, a lot of people run chain the Middle East restaurant, a lot of people have an idea for me, but the only idea we have is just to live and just do what we do, you know? Tough as it is to be independent, you know?
How would you describe, positively or negatively, the whole transition of the music industry in the venue side, which is your...
It's hard to get into the politics of it, just to simplify it to everybody and know what's going on. This is irrelevant to the topic we're talking about. It's like any other chain stores. So in other words, it's only two big cats in town in reality now. Any big acts come to town, they could afford to pay as much money they want. And they can give them one booking all the way from the down south all the way up to Canada, in the east and the west. So to be independent, you really, people gonna come and say, I wanna play the Middle East. I don't care if you wanna book me or don't book me in Florida or New York or Montreal.
Él está hablando lo dramático, el cambio tan dramático que ha tenido la industria de la música que involucra a los lugares donde se toca música. Y ya hoy en día, los músicos son pagados enormes cifras de dinero para tocar en distintos sitios, porque esos distintos sitios son propiedad de grandes corporaciones de música. Entonces, ya lo que queda es esos músicos que aman tanto el tocar en Middle East o entienden el significado de tocar en Middle East, que simplemente dicen, yo quiero tocar en Middle East, y no están sujetos a esas grandes corporaciones. Y so that's what is left.
Exactly. In the same talking, you don't want your musician to be poor just because they love you and care for you. So when they have wings, you're always going to assume they're going to fly and they're going to go for the highest bidder.
Sí, y nunca se descarta de que los músicos, con todo y el amor que puedan tenerle por el Middle East, no quieran recibir su dinero como se lo merecen. Y que muchos de ellos van a ir al mejor postor. So they do come back,
but they do come back in different name than their bands, and it's like a secret shows. You still have them, but they come back secretly because they don't want to be.
And who knows when they're coming back?
A lot of people know. They know their name, they don't know their act or the band name. So.
Muchos de estos grandes músicos que ya están firmados por cantidad de millones por parte de estas corporaciones musicales grandes siguen viniendo al Middle East. De una manera secreta, de una manera que alguna de las audiencias conoce. So what's, unfortunately the time on TV is very short, so we're trying to talk about a history of 42 years in little time. The future of how can a musician still have the Middle East as a venue that is open for them? I mean, what's the future of Middle East for the music industry Boston market?
We're here for all kind of musicians. That's why we have four different stages. We have a stage of 75, stage of 100, stage of 200, and stage of 600.
tienen espacio para todo tipo de audiencia, así que amigos nuestros, músicos o promotores de conciertos. Ellos tienen 4 salas de presentaciones, una con 75, another one, how many, oh, again?
Yeah.
One for, with 75?
75, you have 100.
Con 100 personas.
You have 200.
200 personas.
And 600.
Y 600 personas, o sea que puede realmente hacer su fiesta, su concierto, gran cantidad de músicos latinos. One of the things that a particular area of the Latin market, the Latin venues market here in the Boston is that there is not that many 700 to 1,000 capacity
exactly.
concert venues.
Exactly.
Because it's either a Gannis Arena or a small bar.
Exactly.
In Revere or in Lawrence.
That's why. And big cast, big producers, they don't bother with you when you're small, they don't make money off you. So that's why, you know, when it become over 600, then there is no chance. They're the one who's gonna book the show.
Let's talk about the business numbers, so even though we are a few minutes before. How is the business in a concert of 700 people for a promoter? Because let's teach, maybe there are some promoters over here that they don't know that they can do a 700 people and make how much? I mean, what's more or less the numbers, just to give an idea?
It's all depend based on how much you're gonna charge for a ticket, how much
okay.
people
let's
will
Let's say
to
our
pay
our concerts in the Latin market goes from 35 to $60 a cover.
Okay, we're talking 40, that's 24,000, and you're talking 60 by 6, that's 36,000.
Okay.
So that's
more or less
that's without the cost of the room. Then you take the cost of the room, which is for producing the show, and the rest, we'll give the rest to the promoter.
Right.
Hopefully the promoter will be nice to the artist, you know, and
okay.
give a big chunk to the artist.
Entonces, un concierto de un costo de $40, estamos hablando de $24,000 en ingresos, y él dice que él espera que ese promotor le pague bien a sus artistas, y todavía si llena el lugar, pues podría haber una buena ganancia. Any other advice, Joseph, that you want to give to, you know, about a million of immigrants that are in the surrounding areas of Boston? I would say about 100,000 are watching you right now.
Being an immigrant, you shouldn't even give up hope. But you should know there is 3 stages of immigrants. There is blue collar worker, people who really, there is essentially.
Hay 3 niveles de inmigrantes. Los llamados de cuello azul, obreros, etc.
And the second one is the brain, the global brain, we an essential need for it in the United States. Which is a student who come and graduate.
Los estudiantes y los cerebros que son tan necesitados por el sistema. Now, you know there is a disconnection between those two.
I know that. I'm just throwing it in there.
Okay.
And the third one is if you have enough money to start a business and employ a certain number of people.
Y la tercera es el que ha prosperado, tiene una cantidad de dinero que con la cual podría contratar gente.
So therefore, it doesn't matter the politician delay what they have to delay. There is the essential need for the United States economy to collect the brain power and collect the money. So therefore, I don't know, it doesn't matter how much they delete the paper for the blue collar worker, hang in there, don't give up, it's coming your way. Get out and vote. Make sure all your neighbors vote. Stand for your right.
Los políticos necesitan de los cerebros, de esa parte de los inmigrantes, que son los cerebros, el motor de la economía, y necesitan el dinero de los que han prosperado y tienen el dinero. Y nada de eso puede suceder si no estuvieran y sobrevivieran toda esa gran cantidad de indocumentados y trabajadores y de la clase obrera que viven. Entonces él dice, no hay que perder la esperanza. Y algo muy importante, que nos lo está diciendo un inmigrante exitoso aquí en Estados Unidos. Hay que salir a votar.
Because a lot of immigrants, they don't vote. They don't take it seriously. But keep in mind, you know, 99.99% this country made out of immigrants. So nobody have the right to challenge you. You can't be here, especially if you're out there. And you gotta remember, you are part of North America. The United States, it's just North America. And they need to unite North America one of those days.
So él está diciendo que este país está formado por 99.9% de inmigrantes, de los cuales somos todos, y que no nos podemos dejar intimidar y dejar de votar, porque de esa manera el control no lo tenemos nosotros, y el control se puede tener de una manera amplia, porque este ha sido un país que siempre ha acogido a los inmigrantes. Joseph Sartre, I hope this is not the last interview with us, because this has been a very inspirational conversation. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for your time. Please, get out and vote.
Remember, estamos aquí en el Middle East, en la Massachusetts Avenue con la Brookline Avenue.
Brookline
Street.
Brookline Street and Mass Avenue.
Gracias. Thank you very much.